Welcome to the Think Podcast.
What do you make then of the argument from divine hiddenness? The idea, or maybe you could tell us, what is the argument from divine hiddenness? Who uses that argument? And then what do you think God thinks of that argument?
So it can go a couple ways. By the atheist, what the atheist says is, if God existed, he'd make himself known. Bertrand Russell might say, not enough evidence, God. And the atheist might say, look, if I was a loving heavenly father and I wanted my kids to know I existed, I'd leave notes all around the house. I mean, you know, if I'm invisible, I'm an invisible dad, but I want my kids to know I'm there. Yeah. I'd write things in the sky for them to see. So the idea is, if God exists, he's made himself known. And here's what I love about this. He's not done that. Therefore, he doesn't exist.
Right.
So I'm going to come back to that because that's where I think he's wrong. But unfortunately, a lot of Christian apologists say, yeah, you're right. He hasn't made himself known. But the reason is for soul making. It's called the soul making theodicy. It makes us have to really fight hard to figure out if God exists or not.
Which is, I'm doing like a face palm right now, because doesn't that fly in the face of Acts 17? He is not far from any one of us.
Yeah. Acts chapter, I mean, Romans chapter 1.
God's eternal power and divine nature. His invisible attributes have been clearly seen. So they're invisible, and yet he's clearly shown them.
Here's what I think.
He's made them seen.
Yeah, I think here's where the problem is that there is a distinction between objective clarity. It's objectively clear that 2 + 2 = 4. And subjective clarity, which is that there's a whole bunch of kindergartners who get that question wrong on the first day of math.
Yeah, true.
That doesn't mean that the answer is not clear.
Yeah, well, and not only kindergartners. Nowadays, it's enlightened elite thinkers on Twitter who are trying to find new ways for 2 + 2 = 5 or, you know, 2 + 2 = 4. That's, you know, that's oppressive now. So.
Yeah, math, you have to change math. But I use that example because most people will say, okay, 2 + 2 = 4. Everyone knows that. Back to the atheist. I agree. If God exists, this is actually what my book, The Clarity of God's Existence, is about. Hmm. I take that premise. If God exists and God holds us responsible, then it must be clear that God exists.
Right.
And interestingly, the atheist, my dissertation advisor was an atheist, and the atheist always says, yeah, you're right about that. It's the Christians I encounter who say, no, it doesn't have to be clear that God exists. And they're the ones who are willing to give that up. I'm saying, no, we stand boldly on that point, whether it's with Romans or with the Westminster Confession. We stand boldly on that point. We say, indeed, you're right. It should be clear. And it is clear. And it's our responsibility for not having seen that.
So let me ask you this then. What do theologians get wrong about general revelation?
Here's what I think. Real quick, before I answer that one, can I do one more dimension of the hiddenness?
Please, yeah.
Because this is what I, when I, in my Prom of Evil section at Phoenix Seminary, I go over what I call the pastoral Prom of Evil, which includes the pastoral divine hiddenness. And what I mean by that is, as pastors, my students want to become pastors and go into the ministry of some kind, you're going to encounter people who say, look, I just went through a really terrible time in life. Where was God? That's a problem we also find the psalmist wrestling with sometimes. That's a real problem. I'm not dismissing that or making it sound like it's a simple or easy. Right. The Psalms do a wonderful job. That's our spiritual guide, I think, for that kind of problem. And one of my favorites is Psalm 73. And Asaph goes through this problem in his mind. Of his, life's just not fair. The rich are doing wonderful. I'm not doing well at all. By the end of the Psalm, he's saying, God holds me by my right hand this whole time. I was like a brute beast forever doubting that.
Yeah.
So in other words, God is not hidden. It's back on me to say, why did I ever doubt God? But I think that's one of many Psalms that wrestle through that problem, which is a very real problem, and we shouldn't dismiss or take it lightly. But that problem is one of the things that spurs us, like it did for Asaph in Psalm 73, spurs us to seek after God.
Yeah.